morning we're moving on to 2 Peter, starting with chapter 1. It takes you about 9 minutes to read 2 Peter, so you should be able to do that several times this week. Pastor Carter, just for your point of reference for everybody else in the room, I did a sermon series when I was a youth pastor on this passage, 2 Peter chapter 1. Actually, I just did the series on verses 5, 6, 7, and 8, probably those, and it took me 10 weeks. I'm doing the whole chapter today in one shot. That's how much I have advanced in my life in all of these years. I can cover more territory quicker. So there is much to dig in, and I can't cover it all today, but I want to give some overview and highlight for this that I believe will help us in our faith and help us in our journey with God. 2 Peter chapter 1, the key of this chapter, in my opinion, is this: stand firm on the promises of God. Let your foundation of faith be strongly rooted in the reality of God's word, what he declares. We started off 5 weeks ago looking at stand firm in victory. And then the week after that, stand firm in your identity, who you are in Christ. The week after that, stand firm in your relationships, that being a child of God should affect the way we interact with other people. Amen? It gives husbands directions on how to treat your wives, and wives how to respond to your husband. And anytime we think we know better than God, we're going to get things very gummed up. Stand firm in your faith, a couple of weeks ago. Last week, Dr. Rakes was here with us, did a great job sharing 1 Peter chapter 5, and it's the key verse for this entire series where Peter says, stand firm against your adversary. And that's what Pastor Mike talked about last week, and I'll come back and allude to some of his thoughts in a moment. But in 1 Peter, we get encouragement against outside opposition or persecution. 1 Peter is all about Peter writing to several churches and telling them, you're facing difficulty that's coming from the outside, therefore stand firm and be able to defend your faith against those who would oppose you. If you go back and remember, the opposition came from many who had embraced a cultural mindset that was very secular in nature. And so it was the world against the church. But in 2 Peter, it's a little bit different. It's not encouragement against outside forces, but it's a warning against inside danger. And in 2 Peter, he tells us that we need to be careful to watch and guard against the corruption that can occur within a church when they fail to build on the Word of God. The reality is, this happens quite frequently throughout the centuries. It has happened quite often where, as churches move away from being God-centric to being societal-centric, and they both interact, we can't avoid our responsibility in society. But if that becomes the driving force and God gets left out of the equation, before very long, all we are is a good civic group. And we're called to be the people of God. Now, there's a balance, so in case anyone's getting a little, feels the tension right now, that's good, you should, because the balance is, because of our relationship with God, we are called to interact with society in a positive way. It's not a matter of avoiding it, it's a matter of priority. Our first priority is to God and to His Word, and understanding that reality, that causes us to interact with people in a different way. And I would say this, it's in your notes, it's highlighted there for you, I think, but corruption in the church abounds when the Word of God is not the centerpiece of the church's function. We have to continually go back to the instruction of God's Word, and I'll talk more about that in a moment. To combat the problem of heresy — heresy, by the way, means bad doctrinal teaching, teaching that is anti-Scripture, or teacher that is devoid of Scripture. Those are the things that heresy is. And Peter writes to combat false teaching in the church. Next week, by the way, we'll look at chapter 2, which is all about false teachers and some ways to know who they are and what they are. In 2 Peter, we read the instruction quite frequently to the value of knowledge. As a matter of fact, in these three short chapters, it's about 60 verses. We read 12 times the word to know or have knowledge. 2 Peter also validates the inspiration of Scripture. Three things I want us to see today about what Peter says about knowing God with your heart, knowing God intimately, really having a true knowledge of Him, the importance and value of that. Let me explain what I mean by that. I try to come up with a bunch of illustrations, and I'll probably not go into a bunch of them just for sake of time right now. But people sometimes will ask you, do you know so-and-so? And sometimes you're like, I'm like this anyway. Yeah, I think I know who that is. Or yeah, I've heard that name. But there's a whole different level when they say, do you know someone? And they mention someone that's a very dear friend. When they mention someone that you kind of casually, that you casually know, they go, do you know so-and-so? And the response kind of like, yeah, I've heard about them. I think maybe they live in wherever, and maybe they have this job. Kind of vaguely know something. But when someone asks you, do you know a person that's your close friend, you immediately start thinking, if not saying, oh, yes, I know them well. We went out to eat just a couple of weeks ago. They do this, and we do that, and we've known them. We're connected. They have kids that are this age. And you start knowing them and talking about them in a way that just kind of identifies that you know them in a very close manner. So as you read here, there's a couple of words that come across in the Greek language, particularly the word for knowledge is gnosis, or Gnostic is a group of people who held knowledge as the highest level of blessing. They actually did it in a weird way that excluded God, and Gnosticism is not a good thing. It's a philosophy of religion that elevates man to have knowledge superior to that of God even. Gnosticism was a big problem in the first century church. By the way, I was reading this week, kind of just throw it out here now. Some people say, well, man, I wish I could have been back in the early church when everybody's getting saved. They had problems in the early church too. And the thing is, we need to seize the moment where God's places. God knew you. God knew where you were going to be. He put you in this moment for this time to do His work. Let's let the church rise up and be the church. If I was in the church of ethnicity, somebody would have been shouting right there, come on, Pastor. Need a little help from the congregation. God put us here for this reason. God put us here for this place. God put us here for this time. And knowing God intimately is the foundation of all blessing. Look with me at verses 1 through 4. Simon Peter, a servant. I'm going to get clogged up here today. I know it already. But we started early, so I got a few extra minutes. The word servant there is doulos, which means slave. And we need to probably eradicate this thought from our mind anyway, that we have the option of volunteering to serve God. We look at volunteer as if it's some optional choice that we have control over. God never called you a volunteer. Scripture never identifies you as a participant. Scripture identifies all of us who put our faith in Jesus Christ, and here's the key word, doulos, as a slave to God. Now, I know culturally slavery was a horrible thing when it's man over man. That's an awful, despicable thing, but it is the right and accurate thing when we're talking about the Creator and creation. I'm a slave of God. I don't have the right to create my own agenda. I don't have the right to do what I think I want to do. I have to do what pleases Him. Now, hopefully those two will intersect. And often they do. But they intersect most frequently when, first of all, I'm trying to accomplish His will more than my will. When I'm trying to get Him to line up with me, things are going to be faulty. But when I'm lining up with Him, things will become right. Boy, that's a powerful statement. I hope you got that. I'll come back to it in a minute. Peter says he's a servant and apostle. And notice he mentions servant before he does apostle. He's not trying to list his qualities that would enumerate him as someone of great quality or character. Initially, he says, I have a heart for doing whatever the Lord wants me to do. And secondly, I go as one who has been sent by him. To those who, through the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ, have received a faith as precious as ours. Boy, that's a powerful statement. I'll come back to that in a minute. Grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given us everything. I need everybody to say everything. His divine power has given us everything that we need for life and godliness through our knowledge. There's that word again, not gnosis, but epinosis, E-P-I, epicenter, the center, I mean the dead center, the center of the most center, the knowledge of the most important knowledge, not peripheral knowledge, not knowledge that is just out there filling your mind, but knowledge that enters your heart. Heart knowledge. To those who know this, he's given it through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great. The word great there refers to the quantity or the size. Large, gigantic. One way that word is used in the Greek culture would be adult, full-sized. How many of you like full-sized candy bars better than fun size? That was a marketing genius moment when they called those fun size instead of miniature. It sounds like it's going to be really, really good, but I still like full-size. Can I get a witness? That's what great means, full-size. These adult, fully grown, fully developed, these promises that are great. And the word precious has to do with the quality that they are incredibly valuable. So you get this thought here. Through these, he has given us this abundance of wonderful promises so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption of the world caused by evil desires. The entirety of blessing is based in God's initiative. If you look back in that passage right there, it is God who gives. We are the ones who receives. It is God who calls. We are the one who responds. But it is all initiated by God. Aren't you glad that he loves us enough that he reaches out to us, he calls to us, he gives to us the things that we need, and we simply get to receive it. Now, I'll talk about that more in a minute because that receiving entails now that we start on a journey that is pleasing to him. But it is all initiated by him, and it comes through a heart knowledge. That's what I was talking about just a moment ago of him. Not a head knowledge, but a heart knowledge. I know a lot of people, but I know my family in a way that I don't know other people. It's a heart knowledge. I know them even when they say it wrong. I know them even when they don't do it right. I know them when, even if I'm off, I'll come back around to understanding. It's that thing of after you've known somebody for so many years, you know them and you know their heart, even if their words aren't right. You know their heart, even if other things don't line up, and you know them well. We know God even when we don't understand. All believers share a common faith in that we are equally saved, called, and equipped. We have equal access to the blessings of God, to the goodness of God. The ESV says there, a faith of equal standing. The faith that we have is the same faith that the apostles had. They got saved the same way that we did. Now, there is the gift of faith that can grow in us, but our foundation of faith, our salvation point, we are equally saved just like the apostles were. And you're not getting it now, or somebody would just go, wow, thank you, Lord. Because you're not a second-rate Christian. You're not getting in by the skin of your teeth, because it's not your teeth that counts. It's what Jesus did on the cross. So we have equal access. We come in with an equal standing, an equal place. God's blessings we see here are always abundant. I'm not going to take time to go through this. You got Bible references to look it up later on. But there's abundant pardon. There's abundant mercy, abundant peace, abundant life, abundant grace, abundant joy, abundant power for every child of God. God has blessed you abundantly. Everything you have, everything you need, you already have. You have access to it all. Now, we always need to be growing. We always need to be developing. We always need to be trained. But I'm glad, and again, you can get too far off on this, but I'm glad that what we need, we already have through the power of the Holy Spirit that is working in us. We are sufficient through Him. So I just don't know if I can share my faith or not because I don't know that I'm adequately prepared or trained. Are you saved? Then you're there. I don't know if I know how to pray for someone when they have a need. Are you saved? You're there. God will help you. God will guide you. Do we need to learn? Do we need to grow? Do we need to get better from our ability as much as we can? Yes, but you are ready right now. I think it's a lie of the enemy that comes to us and says, well, you probably shouldn't get too involved in doing anything spiritual yet because you're not qualified. Said who? Because God said you are. So you are. And that's not, don't ever let that be a point of arrogance. Let it always come from a spirit of humility. I'm not qualified because I've studied enough or I'm good enough or I have just natural common sense. I'm equipped. I am prepared because God is in me. I'm glad three of you got that. Through Him, we have powerful provision, everything that we need. Through Him, we have precious promises. Think about some of the promises of God. I just gave you some key words there in your notes. He has promised forgiveness to all who call upon Him with a sincere heart. He's promised adoption, that you will be a child of God. To everyone who received Him, to them He gave the power to be the children of God, the sons of God, to have that right, that position in life. That is a promise of God. He's given you strength. He promises strength. He promises comfort. He promises hope. He promises joy. He promises peace, love, grace, victory, mercy, restoration. The promises of God go on and on and on. And everything that you need, He has provided. I love that old hymn of the church, Great is Thy Faithfulness. There's one line in there that says, all I have needed, you have provided. Whatever your need is today, He is your provision. He has given you everything you need. Why am I pressing this so hard? Because I'm coming against the lie of the enemy, which will tell you consistently you're insufficient. I'm coming against the lie of the enemy that tells you that you got to work a little harder before you can expect that in your life. And I'm telling you, it's not based on you. It's based on Him. And He has given you everything. I feel like just shouting myself right now. If it wouldn't bother you, I might just do it for a minute or two up here. He's given you everything. You're not lacking. You're not insufficient. You're not disqualified. Through Him, you have everything. Now, notice this secondly. Knowing God, not only is it the foundation of all of our blessings, but it results in righteous behavior. Read the next few verses with me there. For this very reason, let's stop real quick. For this, what's the reason? Verses 1 through 4. The fact that He's given you everything, the fact that He has blessed you, the fact that He has called you, the fact that you have the same faith that the apostles have, all of these things, based on that, for this reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and brotherly kindness love. By the way, that right there was about 7 weeks of the series I did as a youth pastor. For if you, and I could do it again, but not today. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive. Wow. and your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But if anyone does not have them, he is nearsighted and blind and has forgotten that he's been cleansed from his past sins. Therefore, my brothers, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never fall, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. D.A. Carson writes this. He's talking about this balance between God does it all, or we got to do a lot of it, or however it works out. And here's what he says. The dominant biblical pattern is neither let go and let God. In other words, just let God do everything and you just kind of sit by and watch him. Or neither is it God has done his bit, now it's all up to you. But rather, it's this. Since God is powerfully at work in you now, you yourselves must make every effort. Isn't that great? It's what Peter says. In view of all of this, that God has given you everything, God has given you great and precious promises, that God has called you to be his child, given you the same faith as the apostles. In view of all that, now you need to make every effort. And it's not a matter of he did a little bit, now it's my turn. It's there is this concert of working together. God is at work in you and through you. And he says, make every effort to make these happen, to make this happen. Peter gives us 7 steps we need to follow in diligence, building our spiritual lives of faith. What does faith mean, first of all? As it relates here, faith is trusting God and remaining loyal to him. I think that often, and I don't know if you have this perception or not, but from my perspective, and I'll give that caveat right out front, from my perspective, often I see Christians who pray for God's will to line up with their will. God, here's what I think should happen, and I'd like for you to do it by Tuesday. And I think we would be better served if we would come knowing he is our Father who has all wisdom, who has all knowledge, who has all provision, saying, God, I don't understand what's going on right now, but I'm asking you to work in my life, work in my heart, work in my mind to bring me in alignment with your purposes. Now, that's not a mark of failure or giving up at all. If you get that, you're not really understanding me clear. It's not a matter of somehow giving up and going, well, I just don't know. I guess we'll just see what God wants to do. No, we're saying, God, I am human. I am finite. I'm not omnipotent. I'm not omniscient. I don't have all power. I don't know everything, but I know you, and I know that you do. So where I'm lacking in my understanding, would you pull me in alignment with your purposes? Would you help me to understand? Would you help me to grow? Would you help me to see? And yet sometimes I think if we're not careful, we're like the prayer that Jesus talks about in the book of Matthew when he says they think because of their continual rambling that they're going to get God's attention. Nobody's shouting on that, but that's good. That's good, Pastor. I'm just telling myself that right now. He says that we need to come in alignment with him, develop the things that help us. Faith is trusting God, remaining loyal to him at all times. And he says, here are the 7 things. He says, first of all, to your faith, add goodness. And by the way, let me jump in and throw this out there right now. There are several times that we see a list like this. Paul gives us the 9 qualities that he calls the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5, 22 and 23. He tells Timothy, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, perseverance, and gentleness in 1 Timothy 6. 4 of these qualities are in Peter's list, and then he adds a couple of others. But this list is not intended to be exhaustive, but it's intended to be a reminder, a suggestion that we can go on. And one person wrote it this way, I agree with it. Why did Peter choose these qualities? Probably because they are the opposite of the evil characteristics that you're going to see in the next chapter. when he exposes false teachers. False teachers did not have moral excellence. False teachers were not Christ-like. They didn't claim, they claimed to have knowledge, but they didn't know God. They lacked self-control. They indulged the flesh. They were not persevering in godliness. They had gone astray. Rather than demonstrating true brotherly kindness and love, they were simply exploiting people for their own gain. He says to us here, develop these things in your life: goodness, moral excellence. By the way, going back to last week, see how many of you can remember, Dr. Rakes was talking about his daughter, and he said there are three key words that she looked at in life and said, these are three things I want in my life. They're all on this list, by the way, in different words. The first one that I remember him talking about was this. It comes up here, integrity. You're not saved by your good works, but your salvation will produce good works. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, let your light shine so that men will see your good works. Now, they're not going to see them if they're not there. And here's the tail end of it. And then they will glorify the Father in heaven. It's not like we're doing our good works to be seen of men, but we're doing good works which are seen by men so that God is glorified. Peter tells us here that we're supposed to do good things. I think it's in your notes, but I've said it before and I want to bring it back again. Good works are not the root or the cause of salvation, but rather the fruit of salvation. In other words, they're the result. He goes on to say a second thing, grow in knowledge. We read in the scriptures that knowledge is often contrasted with ignorance. Knowledge means to have awareness. Ignorance means to not be aware of. And it's often compared between spirit and flesh. It's the second word I think of that Dr. Mike said last week about his daughter. She wanted to have integrity. I think she said this one first, actually. She wanted to have wisdom. God, give us wisdom. Can somebody just make that your prayer right now? God, give me wisdom. Help me to walk in wisdom. The Bible says this, we can make that prayer with confidence because God delights in giving wisdom to those who ask. We need to have wisdom. We need to have that ability to know and have practical understanding of how to apply things. Self-control is the third thing he talks about, which is actually understanding that in the world of the spirit is spirit-controlled. It's when we allow the spirit to control our lives so that we never get in a place where we're out of control. Perseverance, that's the third word she talked about, tenacity. Never quit, never give up, never give in. Keep moving forward. Keep marching toward God. You know, a lot of this will come up in the next passage here, but it's based in an understanding that we are, as Paul said as Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 1, we are pilgrims, we are sojourners, we're people who are on a journey, and therefore we persevere knowing this is not our final destination. I've had a lot of good things happen to me in life and a lot of good experience, a lot of good opportunities. Through the years, sometimes I go places and I've stayed in some really, really bad motels. But I've stayed in some really, really nice ones too. But one thing I've never done, no matter how good or how bad the motel is, I've never hung my own pictures on the wall. You know why? Real simple, because I don't live there. It is a temporary place. Understanding that helps me not to be sad when it's a bad place, or not to be just giddy when it's a good place, because it's just a place to spend the night. Now, I will tell you for the record, I like the better places more than the bad places. But regardless, it's just a place to spend the night. At my house, we got all kinds of pictures up. We got picture walls at my house. Of our family, of our kids, grandkids. It's all up there for everybody to see that comes in the door. They don't have to ask, you have grandkids? We just go, right there. You know what that wall says? It says, we live here. Wow, this could almost get me shouting again thinking about this. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. I have a place that's being built for me, not made by human hands. I have a place whose maker is Almighty God, and it's going to be a place of eternal dwelling. And we got some pictures in our home right now, but my real home is not on planet Earth. My real home is in the heavens. Understanding that gives us perseverance. Let me go back to the illustration. If I go somewhere and I get a bad room where it's not the best hotel around, but it's what the arrangements have been made for me, I can endure it for a night. I can endure it for a couple of days. I can endure it for a week if I have to. Just to be real blunt, sometimes I get a little perturbed at people. That's a nice way of saying I still love them. And I even like them. I'm just a little irritated by them. When they're at nice restaurants and they complain about everything. You got a bed to sleep in? Hush up and go get in your room. We got to focus on things that are eternal, not that are temporal. So we see this here, and it gives us tenacity, it gives us perseverance. The next thing he says, living in godliness, is the next thing he says, add to your faith. Godliness means living as a child of God. And listen, that cannot be fabricated by human effort. It requires God. You can't make yourself godly. No matter how hard you try, you can make yourself kind, you can make yourself thoughtful, you can make yourself sensitive, but you can't make yourself godly. God has to do that. Then he goes on two more. He says, add brotherly kindness. So a lot of times, we take an easy out on this one. We don't feel the need to be kind to some people that we don't really care for, but we'll say this, well, I don't like them, but I love them. Totally anti-biblical. Quit making excuses for bad attitude. You're called to like them. You may not like everything they do. You don't have to approve of everything they're doing, but you still have to have a spirit within you that says, I am going to have brotherly kindness toward them. Let me help you out, make it real practical. That means you don't laugh when they fall. It means you don't look at them when they have a difficult time and go, well, serves them right, they had that coming. But you still have sympathy and empathy for people who maybe get on your nerves occasionally because you are filled with the grace of God, which produces brotherly kindness. By the way, that's one of the nine that Paul gets in the fruit of the Spirit. So if the Spirit of God is in you, this isn't optional. It is what happens as a product. You don't have to go out to a fruit tree and say, come on, tree, give me some fruit. You don't go to the apple tree, come on, apples. You know, apples in the spring. Come on, apples. Let's go, apples. What happens to an apple tree? It produces apples. Doesn't need a pep talk. Doesn't need encouragement. It produces apples because it's an apple tree. Are you a person of the Spirit? Wow, that got quiet real fast. You didn't see that one coming, and that was... I thought it was right in your face, and y'all are kind of like, oh, he got us on that one. I didn't see that one coming. Are you a person of the Spirit? Don't tell me you are. Show me. Because the Spirit produces these things in you. One of them is kindness. Well, they don't deserve it. Exactly. Well, I don't feel like it. Exactly. That's the whole point. If it was natural, it wouldn't be called Spirit. It's not the fruit of your nature. It's the fruit of the Spirit. Kindness. And on top of kindness, add love, which is brotherly kindness is treating people well, treating them as dear family members. Love is a deeper commitment to another person's good. The benefit of growing in godliness and fruitfulness is fruitfulness, awareness, assurance, perseverance, and eternal blessing. Look at this real quick. This growth will positively impact your life in these ways. It will prevent you from being ineffective and productive. When you add those things in your life, it's the last part of the chapter right there, of the passage right there. When you do these things, And if you possess them in continually growing measure, they will help you to not be, they will prevent you from being ineffective and unproductive. How many of you want to have an effective and productive, fruitful life? Just raise your hand right now. The rest, if you don't raise your hand, that basically means like, I really don't care. I hope my life is worthless. We all want to have a life that has productivity, that creates something, that benefits something somewhere, somehow. How do you get there? By doing these things through the power of the Holy Spirit. Remember what we said just a few minutes ago? What this is all about? This is about God working in our lives, working actively in our lives. And because he's powerfully at work in us, we are making every effort. It's coming together with God to make these things happen. When you do these things, it will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive. If you don't do these things, you are nearsighted and blind. I keep pulling these things on and off, and somewhere in the next couple of weeks, I got to break down and go see a real eye doctor and get something besides just reading glasses because my eyes are that bad. So word of just honest transparency for you here. If you're across the room from me and you wave at me and I don't wave back, I'm not mad. I just can't see that good anymore. This has been a developing problem over the last few years, and I've got to go and get something done to make it better because I'm tired of just, you know, so my eyes are out of focus with each other right now. I learned that a year and a half ago, so that's why I'm going to go get glasses sometime in the next month, because I learned it a year and a half ago. They do this thing where like there's two things and they're supposed to come together. Y'all know what I'm talking about with the eye exam? When they do it with me, it is like that forever. They don't even get close. They don't even move. And I told the guy, they're not even moving. He goes, is this better? And by the way, don't y'all hate that? If anybody here works in the optometry thing, stop asking me that question, okay? Is this better? No. 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 And finally, after asking me like 15 times, is this better? And me going, no, no, no. He's like, oh, my goodness, your eyes are out of focus. So I can see you. I just don't know who you are. Don't be scared because some of you think right now, he drives a car. No, I can see. I know what color it is. I can see where it is. Not sure the make or the model, but it's there. Listen, Peter says, if you don't put these things into your life, that's how you're going to be spiritually. Well, I don't know. I can't really see that well. Yeah, because you haven't put the right qualities in your life. It's a powerful word. It's a powerful word. He says, when you put these things in your life, not only will they keep you from being nearsighted. Interesting how he goes on to talk about there that you'll be blind eventually. But he says, not only that, they will, if you don't put these things in your life, you'll forget what God's done for you. When I hear Christians complaining about life, it tells me very clearly they don't remember what God did for them. We sing a bunch of old songs. They were new back then, but they're old now. One of them, I remember as a kid singing all the time, one of those get happy, kind of camp meeting good old songs. Jesus, I'll never forget what you've done for me. Jesus, I'll never forget how you set me free. When we remember what he's done for us, it helps us in the journey of life. Here's a couple of good ones here. He says, when you put these things in your life, they will keep you from falling. How many of you don't want to fall? Then put the right qualities in your life. Be the person you need to be. How many of you want to receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of God? Then put these things in your life. Lastly, Peter says, knowing God intimately, rest in divine revelation. It'll help you when you recognize knowing him intimately is important, but you understand this too, that intimate knowledge comes back to divine revelation, which is the Word of God. So I will always remind you of these things, even though you know them and they're firmly established in truth now. I think it's right to refresh your memory. Go down to verse 15. Make every effort to see that after my departure, you'll always be able to remember these things. We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and coming of our Lord Jesus, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. Down to verse 18. We ourselves heard the voice from heaven, and we have the word of the prophets made more certain. And he said, you will do well to pay attention to it as a light shining in a dark place. No prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation, for prophecy never had its origin in the will of men, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. So he tells us here, there are things that we need to do. We need to persistently proclaim the truth of the gospel. We need to live the gospel out, and we need to proclaim it with our mouth. Some people put emphasis on what you say, others on what you do. Scripture puts emphasis on both. It's what you say and it's what you do. He goes on to say we need to embrace our testimony. We need to be able to remember what God did for us, what he's doing in us, the revelation he's given us. One way we do that is by highlighting it when it happens. And that can be through a journal, that can be through conversation, but too often God does something for us or tells us something and we just kind of go, thanks Lord, and we just forget about it. If we're not careful, we forget what he did for us. I would encourage you to make a journal, make a listing of things God has done in your life. And then lastly, we need to value the word of God as divine. Amen. Now, let me give you some thoughts here as I conclude this morning about what that last passage means. He talks here about the importance of giving instruction that is biblical, that is sound. And here's a couple things that I see. Sound teachers are always ready to remind their students of what they already know. Here's something I see about false teachers. They're always trying to entice you with their new revelation, their deeper understanding. As a teacher of the Word of God, I'm not up here to impress you. I'm up here to tell you what you already know. I want to tell you this morning that Jesus Christ was born of the Virgin Mary. He lived a sinless life. He died on the cross for my sins and for your sins. He was resurrected from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He sent the Holy Spirit to dwell in us. And if we know those things and we walk in that truth, we're not going to fall. I'm always just a little bit leery of guys who are like, I want to share with you the great revelation that I have received from God. By the way, here's a little just tidbit of thought here. We try to watch this and make sure around here, but it's like songs, testimonies, sermons, whatever. When the main part of the subject is I, me, 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 that's not very gospel-centric. Testimonies are good, but it's not very gospel-centric when it's all about, let me tell you what I learned this week. And what if it's all about me telling you how great I am, we got a big problem because I'm not that great. And there is one who is. And that's who we need to be looking at. That's not an excuse for poor living. Surely you got that after today already. But we're not the focus. He is. Sound doctrine is always looking back at the things we already know, reminding us of those things, making them deeper entrenched in our life. Sound teaching emphasizes the basic truth of Christian life. There are things we can know, things we can grow in. Sound teaching is also done in earnest because we know that life is short. You know, when Peter wrote this, this is one of those things that kind of brings you a point of reality. For some of you that are my age or older, it'll hit you too if you're younger. Just give it a few years and you'll be there quicker than you think. When Peter wrote this, he was probably in his 60s. I'm in my 60s. And he's talking about in this book right here, I'm soon going to depart from you. Life can get kind of real if we start looking at it with objectivity. It's kind of funny because we all think we're invincible and we're going to live forever physically, not spiritually, but yeah, you know, how many of you like me? I've been planning on going in the rapture since I was heard about the rapture. I'm like, I'm in on that. And yet I don't know what's going to happen, and I hope that I'm part of the rapture generation. But so did my dad. And so did many, many others who've already gone on. Boy, I hope you hear me right here. My hope for my life is not even based in the rapture for me. Because it may or may not happen in my lifetime. Could happen today. Don't get me wrong. I'm not trying to put it off way out. I'm saying we don't know. Paul thought he was going in the rapture. He said, those of us who are alive and remain. He said, of us. Like he was part of that group. But our faith is built in a God who is faithful at all times. And Peter said, I don't have long to live, so I'm going to make sure I tell you what's important while I still have time. And he tells them, because life is short, live it with that awareness. Another thing I see in his life, because life is short, have a biblical view of death. I got to tell you, when I was reading this, it really got into my heart because I don't know that I've ever heard anybody talk about it. What does a biblical view of death look like? Oh, we hear it at funerals maybe a little bit, but we really don't like talking about death. Can I get a witness? That's why you're so quiet right now. It's not shouting material. But there's a biblical view. Here was Peter's view of death. You remember Jesus told him, right at the end of the life of Jesus, Jesus told him, Peter, one day you're going to be old, and someone's going to take you by the hand and lead you where you don't want to go. You're not even going to have the ability to do anything about it because you'll be old. Peter was very aware of the fact that one day he would die, but it appears very clearly that he was at peace regardless of what happened in life, because when he was taken as a prisoner and he was supposed to be executed by Herod on the following day, that night when the angel came to deliver him, the angel kind of had to hit him on the side to wake him up. He was so soundly asleep. I don't know about you. I know about me. If I knew that I was going to be executed tomorrow, I don't think I would sleep tonight. Peter's not only asleep, he is soundly asleep. Even here, we see Peter who is headed toward death, and he speaks about it with words that are good and strong. He's not worried. He's not upset. But he knows that there is something beyond this life that he is looking forward to. And here's the other thing. When Jesus comes back, according to 1 Corinthians 15, we get a new body. And the new body is not subject to aging, disease, or death. What a great future we have. Last thing, because life is short, we're going to use our days to serve the Lord completely. Retirement's a common theme in our culture today. I had somebody ask me long ago, when are you going to retire? First I was offended, and then I thought, well, I am 63. Just to put your minds at ease or to cause you to pray more, whichever, however, I don't have any immediate plans. I do know they're out there a few years down the road, but I don't know about that. But here's what I know. Regardless of my employment status, I never get a pass from working for God. It may be in a different way. And by the way, some of the worst things that I've seen in my life in the church world are pastors who don't know how to retire. And once they do retire, they're just tied up in knots because they can't figure out what to do with themselves because they built their whole identity on being a pastor. But here's what I know for all of us in the room. Regardless of your employment status, you never retire from being a child of God. You never pass it off to someone else. You may change what you do. You may enter into some new avenues of ministry. But whether that becomes more of an intensified prayer warrior, or whether that means whatever you do with your life, we must make our time on this planet count. Living for God and serving Him every day. Aren't you glad that He uses us, whether we're young or old, rich or poor? You know, when He says we've all been given the same faith, I love that because it means that in God there's no bias or prejudice. Men, women, black, white, Hispanic, Asian, young, old, any kind of label you want to throw out there, God says, I don't see any of them, but I use everyone. Here's my word for you today. Build your life on the Word of God. Allow the Holy Spirit to cultivate the right qualities in your life. Trust in Him every day that you live, because He has given you everything you need for life and godliness. And He has provided to you promises which are massive and valuable. Would you bow your heads with me all across the room? Because of that, if you're here today and you're not a follower of Christ, I want to invite you today to make the commitment to follow Him. I tried to lay it out what it means today to be a follower of Jesus. It's not just about a prayer. It's not just about an occurrence. It all is initiated with an action, but it's a continual lifestyle. So the question today is, are you walking in the lifestyle of being a follower of Jesus? Today, if you're here in the building or if you're watching online, I encourage you right now to say, Lord, I want to follow You my entire life, every day devoted to You. I'm going to do this in the affirmative right now. And really, it's not based on how I ask the question. It's not even based on do you respond or not. It's really based on what's in your heart. But if it's in your heart right now, would you respond with me and say, I want to be a fully devoted follower of Jesus every day of my life for as long as I live. Would you simply just raise your hand right now across the room? Mine's already up. I'm in that group. That's who I want to be. That's what I want. That's the way I want to live. And I want Him to guide me. I want to build my life on His promises, on His Word. Would you stand with me all across this room? Our prayer team's going to come and gather here in the front. If you need prayer today for salvation, for healing, for provision, for deliverance, for wisdom, whatever it is you need today, I want to invite you to come and let someone join you in prayer. Believe today that God's going to meet your need. As we begin to sing this song, if that's you today, if you want prayer, if you want someone to join with you in prayer for whatever need it may be in your life, would you respond right now by stepping out and coming in and join them? Let them pray for you.